very relevant, but I feel that I would like to speak about the epistle because it's so important. And for those of you who weren't here in the morning, it says, brothers, we are justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have obtained access to his grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in our hope of sharing the glory of God. You know what justification means? When you're justified, you stand before the judge and you say, I'm justified because I did what I did, but I'm not guilty. But until Jesus Christ came, we were all guilty. We were all guilty. There was no way that we could be reconciled to God. Because of Adam's sin, we inherited that nature, and we tended to have that human nature, but we sinned, and we turned against God. But we stand justified before God today, because God is a God of justice as well as of mercy. We stand justified before him, not because of our own merits, but because Jesus came and he reconciled us to God the Father. He made us justified before him. Now the question is, in Christianity, I'm not going to give you a comparative religion course, but the Orthodox Church teaches, and we've been accused of not teaching justification. We do teach justification, not in the same sense that other Christian groups do. St. Paul says we're justified by faith, not by faith alone, as many people will say. We are justified and made good with God. Do you know when? In our baptism, when we are cleansed and made perfect in our crucifixion and receive the body and blood of Christ. Now the Lord said, in order to get into heaven, you have to be perfect. Raise your hand, those of you who think you are. I'm glad you don't have that kind of pride, because it requires humility. There's no one who is perfect. And no one can stand before the Lord and say, I deserve to be in heaven. I am getting in because I am good. No. We're getting in because we've been made good by Jesus Christ dying on the cross. And when he died on the cross, he left us, the church, in order to continue that. And through the sacrament of baptism, now I know people sometimes get frightened when they hear the epistle that's read at baptism because it's a joyous occasion, right? And when it used to be read in the foreign languages, nobody knew what it meant. But now when it's in English, and we said, you die with Christ in the water just the way he went into the earth, and you rise with Christ. This is your death and your resurrection. You go, well, this is how we participate in the death and resurrection of Christ through our baptism. And that's why as Orthodox Christians, we dunk them. We don't just sprinkle them, we dunk them because it's dying and rising, dying and rising to new life. And through that baptism, we receive justification. But is justification enough? Our church teaches that in order for justification to be working, for that faith to be true faith, it has to work through love. It has to work through love. And that means that even St. Paul said that we are saved by our faith working through love. So that we have to continue on that road in becoming more and more perfect. Now there are some who believe in a perfect world because no one is perfect on earth. And they feel that you have to be purged of any sinfulness before you can enter into heaven. Do we have purgatory? No. First of all, it's not mentioned anywhere in Scripture. But we pray for the departed, and we do make offerings for them. And people say, well, that's purgatory. No, it's not purgatory. Until the second coming, until we are reunited with our bodies, we let it stay in that place of blessedness. And our prayers help them. Our prayers help them to journey, because we're loving them and they're loving us. And through that, they can continue into heaven. But because we are justified and Christ takes upon us, upon himself, our sins, we then can say, Lord, we have been justified, we've been baptized, we've been crucified, and we live the life of the church through the sacraments. And the sacraments, again, is something that we must continue with all our life, because this is how we receive God's grace. And it's through God's grace that we are saved, because he's a loving God. He loves the world so much and gave his only begotten Son so that we who follow him and believe in him can have everlasting life. And what are those sacraments that we have to partake of? Now, we can't partake of baptism more than once. And marriage, some people do, some don't. Ordination, even more seldom. But all of the other sacraments can be repeated, and they should be repeated, and they should be taken quite often. What are the other sacraments? The Holy Unction, where we get forgiveness of sins and blessings for our health, for good health, and for a good life. Confession. The church instituted confession as a second baptism, because unfortunately we continue to miss the mark. We continue to sin even after our baptism. How are we cleansed again? We can't be baptized again. So we confess, and the Lord forgives us if we sincerely repent. And the church asks us to do this if we have mortal sins. And then the ultimate sacrament, communion, the body and blood of Christ. Through the Holy Spirit, we are given his body and blood to flow within our veins. Christ in us, the Holy Spirit within us. Can we be refused, do you think, when we stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I'm not perfect, but I participated in the sacraments. I did my best. I received your grace. You justified me. Lord, help me. And what do you think he's going to say?
No.
Of course not. He's going to say, yes, my child, enter in. Enter in. Because you have tried. You have loved me. You have participated in the sacraments of the church. There are, according to the official records, only 1 million Orthodox in America. Do you believe that? There are between 5 and 6 million people of Greek extraction in America. Even if only half of them are still Orthodox, that's 2.5 million. Besides the Romanians, the Russians, the Serbians and the Ukrainians who are here in great numbers, there have to be close to 5 or 6 million Orthodox in America. But our official records show 1 million. You know why? Because they said, well, you Orthodox say that to be Orthodox, you have to go to church, you have to participate in the sacraments frequently. And then if you don't, you're not really an Orthodox Christian. And it's only 1 million who do this. Because the others say, hey, I'm Orthodox. When do you go to church? Oh, well, a Christmas and Easter. When I go back to Greece, or when I go back to Romania, they're not counted as Orthodox by the world. By the world. We may say, oh, yeah, there are Orthodox. They're our family, they're our children. But the world says, no, no, no. You can't have it both ways. You can't say that you're Orthodox, you have to participate in the sacraments, a member of a church, a communicant in the church, a participant. participant in the church, and then never go and say that you are. So we have some work to do. We have some work to do. Do we care about our families enough that we want them to be with us in heaven? I would hope so, Lord. I would hope so. That we should care enough for them to tell them right now, listen, you're not going to make it. You're not going to make it. If you don't participate in the church life, in the sacraments of the church. And this is why the church always had the rule that you have to receive communion at least once a year in order to be in good standing. But beyond that, the church in the early days used to say, if you miss church 3 times in a row, and you don't take communion 3 times in a row, you're out. 3 strikes and you're out. It wasn't just the baseball that came from the church. So my dear friends, and myself included, and I have to be reminding you that my own family of this, that it's so important. I'm not looking for people to become members necessarily just for their money. I'm looking for them to be members so that they can be saved and so that they can be with us when we are in the kingdom of heaven, hopefully. The Lord promises us that. Those of us who have been in the church, who have worked in the church, who work towards loving each other, who strive to do the perfect thing, who strive to do what Christ teaches, who participate in the sacraments and say, Lord, I'm not good enough, but make me better. Make me good. Give me your grace and your mercy so that I can have that eternal life that you promise. If we love them, then we have to encourage them. Encourage them. But you know what? The church fathers say, don't nag your children. Pray for them. Let God work in their hearts. Pray for them. That God may indeed turn them to faith so that they can be justified and stand before the Lord. And that would be the greatest gift we can offer them. We save our money, we build up our estates so we can leave to our children. And the best gift, the greatest gift, the most important gift, we don't give them. It's got to be added. It's got to be added. I can't say anymore. So God help us.